We can go ahead and get started. You can let everybody in and then we'll get started at about 2 minutes after.
Okay, starting now.
Thank you to everyone who's joining us today. As you come in, be sure to introduce yourself in the chat and be sure to include your AIA number as well. We are going to give a couple of minutes for everyone to get logged in and then we'll get started shortly. Thank you everyone for joining us. Be sure as you come in to introduce yourselves in the chat and also to include your AIA number. We'll get started in just a moment. Thank you everyone for joining us for our third installment of JE+DI Talks, which is focusing on steps towards inclusion. This third installment will focus on Moody Nolan and workplaces in general as part of a three-part series. In the first part, we really talked about foundational issues when it comes to institutional racism, historical trauma, and how it is impacting the industry of architecture. And then we had a panel yesterday that really focused on academics and the pipeline into the workplace. And so today we'll focus on Moody Nolan, which is one of the largest African-American firms in the country. And we will also watch a short film titled Walk the Talk. So I want to again thank everyone for joining us today. I will go ahead and introduce our panelists. So first we have Elizabeth Robbins. She's the Director of Human Resources and General Counsel at Moody Nolan. She received her BS in education at Kent State University and her JD from Ohio State University. We also have Isoke Miller-Harris. She is an interior designer for Moody Nolan. She received her BFA from Virginia Commonwealth University. We also have Wardell Ross, who is the Director of Operations at Moody Nolan, the Houston office. He has received his BS in Architecture and a Bachelor of Architecture from Kent State University. Then we have Earl Lee, and he is the Director of Experiential Design at Moody Nolan. He received his bachelor's degree in industrial and product design from Columbus College of Art and Design. And then lastly, we have Valerie Franklin. She's an architect and senior associate at the AIA 2001 Architecture Firm Award winner for Moody Nolan. She is a founding member and immediate past chapter president for the Nashville chapter of the National Organization of Minority Architects, or NOMA. She is a Tuskegee University graduate and brings over 21 years of experience with a wide variety of experience, including healthcare, corporate, religious, institutional architecture design.
That's good.
You got the long bio.
Okay. Okay.
I'm in Nashville, and the Nashville link to Moody Nolan.
Thanks for saving me. So okay. We will, we thank our panelists for being here today. What we'll do today is first we will watch the Walk the Talk video. Then we will engage in some Q&A, both from myself and the audience. So we can go ahead and move into that video now.
Yeah, yeah. Whoa, hold on. Ultra Park. Walk it like I talk it.
Walk it.
Walk it like I talk it. Walk it like I talk it.
Woo.
Walk it like I talk it.
You.
Walk it like I talk it. Walk it like I talk it. Walk it like I talk it.
Woo.
Walk it like I talk it.
Hey.
Walk it like I talk it.
Walk it.
Walk it like I talk it.
Walk it.
Walk it like I talk it. Walk it like I talk it.
Woo.
Walk it like I talk it.
Talk it.
Walk it like I talk it.
Hey.
Walk it like I talk it.
Woo.
Walk it like I talk it.
Yeah.
Take my shoes and walk a mile, something that you can't do.
Woo.
Hey. Big tops of the town, big boy gang moves.
Gang moves.
I like to walk around with my chain loose.
Chain, chain.
She just bought a new shoe, but got the same bitch.
Same boo. Gang.
Walk it like I talk it.
Walk it.
Walk it like I talk it.
Walk yeah. It.
Walk it like I talk it.
Talk it.
Walk it like I talk it.
Woo.
Walk it like I talk it.
Walk it.
Walk it like I talk it. Walk it like I talk it.
Talk it.
Walk it like I talk it. Let's go.
Hello, everyone. My name is Isoke, coming to you from Moody Nolan. Today, we're going to explore our grassroots diversity and inclusion series called Walking the Talk and how you can get one started in your own firm. But first, let me introduce the team that created it. We have Earl Lee, Elizabeth Robbins, Wardell Ross, Antoine Bryant, Drew Deering, and myself, Isoke Miller-Harris. So let's get started. Our Walking the Talk series has this curriculum of 34 topics created by this team and the staff at Moody Nolan. In describing the Walking the Talk series, we've broken it down into four phrases. The spark, which is how the idea started. The start, which is how we got started. The look, which is where we'll go through the presentation and what that looks like. And the growth, where we'll discuss how the series has grown since its inception. So let's get started with the spark.
So let's get started. Following the murders of unarmed blacks by police, Moody Nolan started to get many requests from media, magazine, and business magazines just about what our opinion was. And these ranged from a wide range from, you know, race and equality in the AEC industry to diversity and inclusion in the design industry. And then also requesting information about how we felt and how we viewed some of the unrest that was happening in a lot of our cities. And so one of the things we started to realize is that, you know, Moody Nolan was starting to be looked at as one of the voices of Black people. And to really understand that, you know, as a Black-owned firm, we really had to say, okay, well, we really need to watch what we're saying and be very, very forward in exactly what we're saying and be purposeful in it. And so we really started to look inward to say, okay, well, what are our views on some of these things? And what are our stances so that when we do talk, we are speaking from the heart of Moody Nolan and not necessarily just speaking from, you know, what our personal opinions might be.
Exactly. You know, as the largest minority-owned firm in the country, we were in a very unique position. And so a lot of media outlets were calling on us to weigh in on a lot of topics. And that was certainly part of the spark that got this all started. Another thing that was happening at the same time is we were having one-on-one conversations. A lot of people within the firm, just like a lot of people across the country, were talking about what was going on. And Earl and I started having a lot of these conversations around what was going on in society, how that was impacting the members of our firm, and how we could better support the members of our firm by leaning into these conversations instead of stepping away from them. So those one-on-one conversations started to grow. We started to pull in people. And it was a very organic, you know, it was Earl and I on the phone, and then we called Wardell, and then we called Antoine, and And next thing you knew, we had five or six of us on the phone, all just having this conversation about the impact of what was going on, and then how that was impacting the work life and what we wanted to do within our firm to start to address this. You know, one of our core principles is that we are one Moody Nolan. We are spread out over 11 locations, and we're made up of a diverse population of different races and genders and sexual orientations, but we are one firm, we are one unit. And we recognize that what our firm needed to really embrace being one Moody Nolan was what the whole country needs. It was conversation, it was education, it was perspective, it was understanding. And you know, through all of these different, different things that were all happening at the same time, we recognized that what we needed to do was to go ahead and start a group discussion series.
And, you know, and with that one Moody Nolan, to us, it was about really having and creating real relationships, and not just real relationships between, you know, Moody Nolan and the community, but real relationships internally. You can't have a real relationship if you don't know another person's, you know, story. And this idea that we in the design industry, we tell stories all the time with our buildings. We tell stories all the time with our designs. But the idea of being able to understand the stories of each other really puts us in a position to understand who we're working with. I mean, it's already been proven that design gets better when you have a diverse team. And so we wanted to make sure that, okay, we are having the right conversations and we are giving ourselves the things that we see the world needs. We're making sure that we want to be able to give those things to ourselves. And so when you really start to think about even the name, Walking the Talk, that's where it came from. You know, everyone knows Moody Nolan as this, as a Black-owned, very diverse architecture firm. And to the idea that we speak that all the time. We make sure everyone who hires us, people who ask for us, they understand where our roots come from and what we're about. But the question of, well, do we walk that same talk within our walls? And we make sure that these real relationships are being fostered. We make sure that everybody understands the gravity of which Moody Nolan has, that, you know, this is something that doesn't come along every day. You know, the idea that you have a Black-owned firm as large as we are is something that should be cherished. And it really should be something that everyone within the walls needs to understand how great that is. Because, like I said, it's something that should be cherished, and it doesn't happen every day.
I think another component of that too is the understanding of how we are viewed. You know, being a minority-owned firm, just like the media was asking us to speak for, you know, the voice, we're also kind of that image that, you know, if we do something, then that's kind of a representation of the entire, minority population of designers. And so making sure that everyone within the firm was embracing that fact that, you know, when we are out in the world and we are being individually, perceived, that we are really kind of standing for the entire firm and in some ways and standing for the entire minority design community.
You know, now we'll talk about the start, how we got going. You know, the first thing we did in this process was to get approval or buy-in from senior leadership. And we wanted to make sure that senior leadership kind of understood the vision of these firm-wide discussions. So we communicated to leadership several things they needed to consider. The time it was gonna take for the discussions. We knew that it wasn't going to be strictly 230 minutes. You know, what was the rhythm that we needed to have? And we got buy-in and ultimately became about an hour and a half. Next thing we did is we had to communicate that in this time we're gonna, it was gonna take to put this together, and the participation was going to be the loss of some staff productive hours, not only to set up the presentation, but to participate in it as well. And then we also went and we had to explain the type of content that this was going to engage. and it wasn't going to be easy content from start to finish.
I agree with all that, Wardell. I think one of the things we want to emphasize is as leadership is considering each one of these points, it becomes a matter of perspective, right? So even the time for discussion, even the time that may be seen, quote unquote, as loss of staff hours, each one of the participants played a key role in the betterment of the organization. I thought when we were doing this, that even though, quote unquote, these weren't billable hours, these were things that added to the strength and growth of our organization. And I think that was definitely one of the selling points that we were able to use when we were getting that buy-in by our senior leadership.
So next, we had to assemble the troops, and you know, we needed to have and build a team to support the structure. That was remarkably easier than we had expected because of the climate of what was going on in the country. So a lot of people were interested. So what we did is we rallied participation first from people of color within Moody Nolan. Moody Nolan is incredibly diverse, and many people wanted to enter the discussion, but we wanted to really pull in the folks that seem to be affected by things the most. And so we got widespread buy-in from all various departments all over the firm. We really grew a team. We gathered the staff and gathered staff committed to change. So what that really looked like is we reached out, we really heard from each person individually and cast the vision and saw places where they could then be a part of what we were doing.
Point that I want to kind of pick up on that you said, Wardell, was in growing that team, we were very intentional to make sure we got people like across the professional spectrum, right? So there were some senior leaders, but also some younger employees, right? That still have very tangible experiences and background for us to leverage. And to also show that we were intentional to hear from various age groups, right? So that was something that I think we did, and we did very successfully. Then additionally, I think we got a lot of energy by gathering our fellow colleagues, because this was a chance for some people to share and experience in a capacity they never had an opportunity to do so. So the rallying of the troops, as it were, was a lot easier than any of us could have expected, because many of the topics that we chose to discuss were on the tips of the tongues or going through people's minds for many, many months. And so this allowed them an opportunity to have a safe place to really talk about some of these things.
So we looked at, in structuring, how do we phase this? So we needed to understand how we got here. And so we always wanted to base that in evidence, in historical fact, and trying to get, you know, purely really kind of down the line. We then needed to understand where we were going. Great to understand what the history is, but where are we trying to go? And then lastly, you know, making it personal to Moody Nolan, what can we do about it? And that is what we've been finding great value in communicating that to staff. How can you play a part in this? And, you know, it's been an amazing thing.
It's been really, really good. It's been really strong. I think each one of these points, let me just reemphasize what Wardell presented, because each of them are integral. Each of them are part of every single session, right? When we did it, each one of these phases was part of the session, so that when people walked away from it, they had a very tangible understanding, not only of policies and procedures in this nation, but also why the responses that we see in this in our country during this pandemic and during this season of unrest, how we got here, but then also what can I do about it? If I'm an architect at a firm, how can I make a difference in my community? How can I make a difference in society? And one of the things we wanted to ensure was that it's integral and important that you understand how we got here, right? It wasn't just a man being murdered because a policeman put his knee on his neck, but what kind of circumstances created the reality where that's something that people felt was okay and that right. He felt was okay.
Right.
You know, people responded to it by protests and by taking to the streets, but were they just responding to just that? Or were they responding to decades upon decades of inequity and inequality? And the reasons why those inequity and equality, how did we even get there? You know, we had discussions about systemic racism. We had discussions about redlining, and a lot of people don't know that those things exist, right? A funny anecdote, and Wardell knows this, we had to spend 5 minutes talking about, you know, redlining is not what you do to just CDs, right? I mean, it's an entire process that was designed by the real estate community, you know, 70 years ago, and what the detriment of effects that they had on communities of color, right? And so really talking of drawing that line, and then what can we do? Okay, now that we understand our historical context, now that we understand why communities are in uproar, how can we as individuals make a difference moving forward? And I think we gave people some very tangible things that they can do in their micro communities, as well as in the societies that we all live in, to make all of our communities much better. And so now, as we transition, you guys have begun to hear a lot about how we got here, the things that we thought about, the kind of topics I'm going to discuss. But since we're architects, we got to put together what the look of this was going to look like.
At the beginning of every session, we start off with a brief intro. This basically just goes through the ground rules of conversations and the discussion, and we just want to make sure that everyone understands that we're here to learn, respect each other's opinions, and start to create and foster real relationships. Next, we pass the mic by letting 3 to 4 members of our staff tell us about how they feel and about how they are processing things in the current climate of racial tension. This not only gives speakers a chance to express themselves in a safe place, but it also gives others the opportunity to hear and see their story. After pass the mic, we do what we call level setting. This is done with either a video, information compiled, or a presentation that gets everyone on the same page of what today's topic is.
Why do alarm bells go off whenever people talk about how Black people just love fried chicken and watermelon?
Another part of level setting is what we call Words of the Day with Jay. This is where we take everyone through the terminology and their definitions so that we can make sure everyone understands what we're talking about throughout today's topic. When the opportunity presents itself, we call upon outside experts to add insight to our topic of discussion. Utilizing external experts can not only be an effective way to understand another viewpoint, it can also be an effective way to help others see that we all have feelings, that we all are human, and that not everyone is our adversary. If given the opportunity, don't hold back with the hard questions. The questions are what will make your dialogue engaging and healing at the same time. Many of our presentations have a lot to do with how our past has shaped today. So to make that connection, we use factual data pulled from historical records, research studies, and websites that provide the needed detail to make the case. Another tool we utilize are interactive websites. These can show in real time how what was done in the past has shaped what we're seeing today. They can also reveal connections to some of the systemic issues many of us face today, such as unemployment, housing, education, health, and healthcare. One example of how we use this type of data is with the connection between redlining and COVID-related cases. We can use the historical redlining maps and compare them with asthma-related emergency room visit maps to reveal the similarities and disparities. These disparities are what we're also seeing with COVID today across all peoples of color. To keep our staff's attention, we sometimes add analytical questions throughout the presentation, along with hints that if they've been paying attention, they should be able to apply the data and derive the answer. sometimes the dialogue is our primary focus. These sessions usually have about 30 to 45 minutes of a topic-based presentation, followed by a question for a 50-minute discussion period. Throughout our series, we do our best to stay current and humble to any events that add to the current climate, making sure we don't just inform our staff of the events, but to give everyone a chance to talk freely about their feelings. In staying current, we've also taken time to acknowledge the loss of some of our best heroes by getting our staff to remember the good moments, moments to smile, or even moments to laugh. After every session, we like to give a preview of the next session. This gives our staff the chance to investigate the topic, prepare questions, or what's most important, volunteer to help moderate a subject they're interested in. We close out every session with the same two slides and thoughts. We are one Moody Nolan, and the statement that this is our world and it's up to us to shape it, or somebody else will. Well, we hope you enjoyed viewing many of the components that make up our Walking the Talk Diversity and Inclusion series. And next, Anton and Drew are going to talk about how the series has grown.
And now the growth section. I think one of the things that we've been excited, has been a pleasant surprise, has been a considerable and unexpected growth since we began this several months ago. This growth has contributed to the factors that cannot be underestimated. We're extremely excited about how this has been embraced by many of our colleagues across all of the offices. And I think part of the key factor to success has been the consistency that we established from the very outset. From the very beginning, we wanted this to be something that people could look forward to. I look forward to participating in, as well as learning from. And keeping it on a schedule is something that now people can have it on their calendars to look forward to. It's been going on a weekly basis for a number of months, where we just switched to bi-weekly very, very recently. Drew, what did you think about the consistency as well?
Yeah, and I think it helped, played a lot of big factor into that, knowing that it's over on a Friday on lunch, you know, you can get your sandwich ready for a Friday presentation. It's been very interesting. We've been able to make consistency between 80 to 90 people on a weekly basis, which is basically almost half of our office. Show up for this conversation. So it's been a great part to be to the success of this.
Additionally, I think that, you know, the consistency, one of the things we wanted to maintain throughout and being able to maintain legitimacy with all of our conversations was research, right? We weren't just talking, we weren't just merely sharing opinions or ideas, but we were fastidious about ensuring that this was all evidence-based and it was factual in all of our discussions. We also were very intentional to be nonpartisan. No matter what anybody felt one way or the other, on one side of the aisle or the other, we were intentional to kind of just, these are just the facts. These are just history. And one of the things we found was that a lot of the things that we discussed were not necessarily immediately known. Whether you were white, black, or whatever, a lot of the history and a lot of the facts that we discussed were new to many. And I think that's what led to a lot of introspection, as well as some easy acceptance from many people.
Yeah, we're a profession, so interesting to know about the actual facts that are coming to there. As Antoine said, it just wasn't a conversation. It was, we always had a part of a presentation that someone prepared, had some factual information, some history to the topic. So it's more deep dive into it, more of an educational presentation than just, you know, a couple of colleagues sitting around having coffee talking about current events.
And I think that that research part was key to ensuring that a lot of people became part of it and wanted to be part of it. As part of their research, we recommended books for people to read. We recommended videos and films for people to watch that would really have a definitive statement to say about things. Some of the books that we cited were The Color of Law by Richard Rothstein, were How to Kill a City by P.E. Moskowitz. We recommend people watch The 13th by Ava DuVernay. I mean, it's those kinds of things that were very factual based, that are very definitive about many of the subjects we were discussing, and allowed for an unvarnished view of history that was untainted necessarily by one's political viewpoints as well. And once people saw and people embraced that these things were very factual based, it became easy to bring people in, right? A lot of our colleagues were able to share, a lot of our colleagues were able to participate, but we also took that opportunity to reach out to others to play a part in this. I think our most recent presentation on policing, we were very intentional to reach some experts. And Drew, if you remember that one, we can talk about that.
Yeah, it was very interesting. As we all know, policing is a current topic here today. So we brought in five or six police officers, diverse backgrounds, from a city police officer to some people on the federal force, and brought their perspective, both Black, white, brown, male, female, and how those interactions are seen from their side, because we often hear about one side. But it was very interesting, the diverse backgrounds, to hear from their side and how it affects them, and bringing those personal stories and relating to us. Also point out, this recruitment also helped us, the diversity of just our own staff. You know, we have people across 12 offices, people from different backgrounds. They brought those expertise into this conversation, brought their passion, brought their knowledge into there, to allow everyone to share their story and show this passion to make our office better.
And what's phenomenal about that part, Drew, is that you had an opportunity for our own colleagues to present their backgrounds, as well as both academic and professional, and they're able to speak from skill sets that they may not have had the opportunity to present in the traditional architectural capacity, right? You know, we found out that some people have planning backgrounds. We found out that some people have a different form of upbringing that we would have expected. We found out some people came from overseas and then had a totally different understanding of what race relations and race dynamics were in America. And so all of those kinds of experiences, both professional and personal, really added a richness to our discussion. So recruiting people from without and from within, we think, is a key attribute to maintain with this moving forward. And all of these led for an opportunity for us to really keep it interesting. You know, some of these topics could be kind of heavy. And so one of the things we wanted to do was be intentional to kind of make it rich, to make it fun. For sometimes, you know, if it's something that you're going into, we want you to come out having learned something, but also, how can I do something as an architect, or how can I do something as a designer, or what can I grow from in this conversation to add to not only my personal life, but also to society at large.
Yeah, one of the great things for me was just the open mic session and hearing all these people's stories, you know, being a leader in the profession, understanding how their stories and how I can make the profession better, how I make the office better, you know, learning from that and making sure they're engaged to it and making our profession better. And also the response to the current events. These things are still going on. You know, there's news every day about some other story going on. Bringing that portion into our everyday lives. Very often these things are talked about, and sometimes they are or are not talked about in the office. You know, they're all in people's minds, but here we had the chance to actually sit down as an office and talk about these current events and get people's thoughts and feelings about them.
And I think that link to the current events really allowed us to bring the relationship to historical antecedents, and how those kinds of actions and those kinds of policies led to some of the frustrations which manifested in some of the unrest we saw, right? When we look at, you know, the unfortunate murders, quite frankly, of people of color that were being exposed many times this summer, the responses that you saw weren't necessarily born exactly and specifically from those events, but also because of buildup of other events that have been happening over decades. We had the opportunity to talk about the racial wealth gap and the reasons for that. You know, we're born in the 30s and 40s with the lack of accessibility to mortgages by households of color, and how that manifests in our communities today. Many of those discussions, people had not and no understanding or capacity for the history for it. So being able to present that from a purely historical basis lent an understanding to the current events of today. And because we had the open mic session that Drew specified earlier, we got to hear from one another in a safe place, in an understanding place, but that provided a very authentic voice, right? We got to hear, our firm is incredibly diverse, and you got to hear specifically from each other how and why people are living the way they are. And then, of course, we had to marry all of this with some sharp visuals. You know, we are, you know, an
architects after all.
I mean, that's what I heard, Drew. That's what I heard, you know. And I dare say we're one of the best ones, yes. And so, you know, we had a team that made some really engaging visuals. I don't know, Drew, you remember any that you like specifically?
No, there's always the funny videos our colleague early pulled in, you know, I don't know if ashamed or proud of some of those photos, you know, some crazy videos we found, but, you know, just a shout out to our environmental design team, you know, and the great graphics they presented in those. I always say, as an architect, on everything we do, it should look like an architect did it, not just the boring graphs, boring blank white, and, you know, black letters on white page, so.
Right. And I think that level of very intentional graphics lent and kind of wrapped up the presentation with a bow, quite frankly. So you're able to marry fact-based data, fact-based information, very authentic conversations and viewpoints from a variety of perspectives across the firm, the expert participation of outside counsel, and then being authentic and being very true to our mission with a well put together presentation is something that can really create a model that can be replicated across the country. And so I'm just excited, quite frankly, to have been a part of this now and going forward.
Today, we're gonna talk a little bit about how you can get this started at your own firm. And the first step in that process is to assess. This is going to be taking a really honest look at your firm, at your firm's culture, at the people within your firm. So first, examine your firm's culture. Every firm is different. There are really big firms, there are really small firms, and every one of them is unique in how their culture is. You're really going to have to take a deep, honest look at where your firm's culture is at. Next, you're going to have to identify the need. And, you know, having looked at your firm's culture and done that honest internal look, you'll start to recognize, you know, what it is that is needed by your firm on these topics. And you need to know your audience. You need to know what people are curious about. You need to know where people are at and where you want them to be. And that gap between the two is where this program can step in and start to move and close that gap. And then you're gonna need to know how to draw lines. And that again is gonna go back to your firm culture. Our firm, as you know, we're pretty tight knit and we're pretty informal. So with our programs, we were able to infuse a lot of humor, which was successful. That wouldn't be appropriate at all firms. We were able to push the line a little bit. And again, you know your firms pretty well, but just be cognizant of that and mindful of that. What's appropriate at one firm wouldn't fly at another firm. And you want to make sure that you're doing this in a way that's going to be received by the people in your firm.
So the next step is plan. So you definitely want to get leadership support. You really, you know, leadership support is about knowing kind of the temperament of the leaders. You want to start with the leaders that you might know. In particular, you might have leaders that are in HR. You might have leaders that are kind of the design leaders or business development leaders. But leaders, nonetheless, really at the top and all throughout your particular organization.
If you're at a larger firm and you're not certain who to go to, like Jason, like Wardell said, you're gonna start with the ones you know, and then ask them, where do I need to go? Who do I need to take this to? And if HR is at your firm, that is a great resource either to help get that support or at least to point you in the right direction.
And so you then, in talking about buy-in and sign-off, that is a very critical piece. It's not enough just to have leadership support. Support can be from a distance, but buy-in means that you may regularly see them. They're going to participate in what you're doing. They're going to endorse what you're doing, help steer it to some degree. But they're really a partner with you in this, and they get sign-off. You then want to set expectations, set reasonable expectations, actually. And so, acknowledge what you can do. What is it, based off the size of your firm, the culture, all the things that we just talked about, what can you actually do so that you can still keep some momentum and you don't get discouraged? Absolutely.
The next step is going to be to gather. And there's a lot of things that are going to be gathered before you get started. The first thing you're going to gather is you're going to assemble your team. Your team might be you. Your team might be you and one buddy at work. Your team might be 15 or 20 or 30 people who are all super excited and really, you know, want to put the work and the effort and the commitment in to making this happen. Whatever your team is, pull them all together.
And team is the operative word. You know, if you're a team of one, you know, that goes back to knowing what you can do. But also if you have a team of others that actually have other people, they need to be bought in as well. They need to add to the process and they need to help you in the whole gathering process.
Once you get that team, then you're gonna start identifying your topics. So how you identify your topics is gonna work a little different with every group. We started by having the team put together their ideas around topics, but then we did a brainstorming session very early on with the whole group. We probably had 115 people on the call and we just opened it up. What do you want to talk about? What do you want to use this space? That was really helpful in getting the entire group that was participating, not just the leaders of the sessions, but the entire firm participation, really engaged in the process and buying into it because they were able to put forth some topics. And the topics aren't going to be the same at every firm. You know, back in that assess phase, you learned, you know, where you were at and where you wanted folks to go. That's going to be different at every firm. So what the topics are going to be is going to be different at every firm.
You also know there in with the topics is that, you know, many times that information will come in. And what we actually did is we started to group them to kind of create topics that would cover the various nuances of different things that were related.
Once those topics are identified, then you can start gathering your resources. And in this day and age, it is really easy to get some help from the internet. So internet videos were incredibly helpful to us. There are some really great videos out there that are, you know, succinct and well done and well put together that we were able to just pluck off the internet and play as part of our session. Also other online resources, we were able to get lots of data and lots of infographics. Just be a little mindful of the source. There's a lot of really great, well-researched, well-done materials out there, but there's also some not factually supported information out there. So just want to be really mindful of the source when you're plucking off the internet and then, you know, sharing in these sessions. Two other resources you can gather are going to be experts, and you can look to experts in the community or you can look to experts within your own office. For us, the experts in the community is something we've just recently started adding. We had a session on police and policing, and we brought in four different law enforcement officers to learn their perspective. That's a perspective we don't have within our walls. Right. So by reaching out into the community, we were able to get some different perspectives and have some really great conversations. And then also experts within your own office. A lot of the topics we've covered so far have had a really close nexus to architecture. And so we were able to, you know, use experts within our own office who knew a lot about gentrification or knew a lot about redlining and had already researched these topics, knew about these topics, had presented on these topics, and were really excited to be able to, you know, join the team and present.
The final step in all of this is just get started. You want to kind of push out and jump into it. The first thing you have to do in getting started, you got to set ground rules. You want to be respectful. You want to make sure this is a safe place for people. And those ground rules will allow people to really understand that that's truly something that this process will adhere to. And then let it evolve. Even when you set the ground rules, the process will evolve. You'll learn new things and then you'll implement them. You also want to be open-minded to where it can go. And I think for us, we found that to be a very liberating process because we started something, we put the skeleton together, we learned. But as things came up, as things we learned, hey, maybe we can do that better, we were open-minded to where it could go.
This was one of the big keys, I think, for our program. We had a schedule, we had all the topics, we organized them, we set dates to all of them. And then Jacob Blake was shot. And, you know, we were about to have a session, I don't even remember what the next one was gonna be, gentrification. And it just didn't seem authentic to stick to the schedule and talk about a, you know, historical or policy-based topic when there was yet another example of what had really been the spark for all of this. So, you know, the team got together and decided, you know what, we're gonna take a break from where we were, and we're gonna just have an open sharing session. The rule follower in me, the HR person in me that likes to follow all the rules, was like, no, we have a schedule, we have to stick to the schedule. And the team said, no, we really need to take a break from the schedule. And I said, yeah, you know what, you're right. And it turned out to be one of our most impactful sessions. And then as part of that too, the idea came up, it was Wardell's idea actually, to do a session on police and policing and bring in some police perspectives and get those voices in the room. And so our commitment to being open-minded has led to two of our most impactful sessions, and we wouldn't have had those had we just stuck to the original plan.
Absolutely. You know, also, you know, kind of wrapping it up, be consistent. You know, you've started, you're open-minded, it's moving forward. But the important thing is there needs to be a rhythm created so that people can start to get comfortable and rely on the fact that we will still have these conversations. Again, you've already gotten leadership buy-in, you have a team, you've put together a skeleton, you're working through things, but the important thing is not to stop. You know, you might want to make it a reoccurring event, but you need to understand kind of what that rhythm can be. And then you really just want to keep at it. You'll learn things, but keep going. You know, it evolves, and, you know, it's a wonderful ride.
This is definitely something that is doable at all of your firms. And if you have the opportunity to do this, we hope you'll reach out and let us know how it goes.
Absolutely. Good luck.
That was a wonderful video. Again, that was titled Walking the Talk from Moody Nolan. And this leads us into our Q&A section for today. First, I want to invite everyone to turn on their cameras so that we can have a different type of conversation. We can see each other if possible. I first want to start with just as a consultant in DEI space and trauma-informed practices, that this is a great program that is very comprehensive, and it's something that I always suggest with my other clients, that they have something that's consistent, that they have something that fits their workplace culture. So I want to start off with that. And then second, I want to ask first, it seems as though the program is working well. You have half of your staff that is participating actively. But were there any barriers that stood out to you, any difficulties that arose that you were able to overcome or not? And I want to put that to our panelists today.
Jump in with something. Sorry, just can't hear me. This is Earl Lee from Moody Nolan. One of the things that was kind of unforeseen is since when we started this, it was kind of in the middle of the pandemic. You're still trying to adjust to work from home. And if you were to actually go through one of these presentations, you'll see it is a lot of information. And so not only did we have to do the research, we had to do the research, compile it, make it look visual,
and then give ourselves a reality check of like, okay, now are we hitting them with too much and the kitchen sink, or do we need to pare this stuff back? Because, you know, it's like we would, you know, it would just be a lot of information, and some, you know, it's hard to get people to pay attention if it's too much. So, you know, I would try to say we probably underestimated or overshot our goal. And when I say overshot, it looked great. Everything looked great, but it was taking so much time to pull it together. And so when we first started, you know, it was really funny because at first it was going to be like, okay, this is just going to be one day. And then, you know, it kind of steamrolled and said, well, we could make it a series. So in my mind, I was thinking, okay, it'll be a series that lasts 2 months. And then, you know, Elizabeth's like, well, hey, why does it have to have an end? And then when we threw it out to the staff, it was like, okay, we got 58 topics. Okay. So it just ballooned. And then we were going to try to do it every single Friday. Well, you guys know, yeah, right. Like every Friday we would hit the Friday, but then none of our regular work wasn't getting done. So then we had to start spacing it out, just to give ourselves time to compile the useful information and put it out there. And, you know, we're about to go into, part two of the whole series. And, although it's fun, we learn a lot even by putting the presentations together. I think we went from every Friday to like every other Friday, and then we're like, oh, maybe we should just do it, you know, once every 2 to 3 weeks. Like, you know, we still have to figure out our frequency because obviously the workload comes first. But the key is, I think if you heard in the video, Jay said, you know, you can't just stop. You can't just say it's not worth it. It's just one of those things where we have to figure out how to do it. Now that some people are coming back in the office and we're seeing each other a lot more, it's going to be a little different. But I would just say underestimating how fast or how hard it can grow. And, you know, even now we got people saying, hey, when is part two starting back up? I'm like, you know, I'm waiting. And it's one of those things where I'm like, okay, let me get some breather room and get some of my work done, because I know when it starts, it's a whole nother effort parallel. So I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. Any other panelists want to chime in on any persistent barriers to your DEI efforts overall?
I just want to chime in on what Earl just said about the frequency of the sessions. Earl, I think it was, even though it was just like, okay, let's start to slow these down, I think it was relative to the amount of pain and healing needed at the time. So when we first started them out, you know, it was like in the midst of George Floyd, it was like every week, and it was like, we wanted them like every week. It was like, we need these, we need this outlet every week. And then when that healing started happening, you know, through these sessions and through the discussions that we had, we felt like we didn't need them, you know, as much. And then we can kind of space them out every other Friday, but they still needed. And I think that the fact that, you know, they kept up with current events, you know, because after George Floyd was Ahmaud Arbery, you know, was Elijah McClain, you know, and it wasn't just like a one and done. It was like, okay, this is an ongoing thing that we're gonna have to kind of work with our staff to acknowledge that they are feeling pain personally, you know, from these events. They may not be able want to go to work or go to this meeting today because of this, you know, so let's discuss it. So I think, you know, the timing, it has to be based on what's going on, you know, as well.
I was trying to hold for others to talk, but I'm going to pick up where Valerie just added to. I think a big challenge was kind of to focus our passion. You know, talking about these things, having an outlet to talk about these things, is very therapeutic. It's great. It also produces a lot of additional things that come from it, because just the dialogues we were having that didn't even get out for mass consumer consumption were healing. It was just like we were going back and forth about how we were seeing things or how it was affecting us, calling various people. But there were also that produced a ton of, I guess, extracurricular activities as well, with people who at the time when we started weren't necessarily comfortable to talk in the bigger setting. We were successful in creating an atmosphere where they were like, okay, hey, can I talk to you offline? And that was okay for a while, but we would always encourage them, okay, your voice is needed for the larger group. And this may be your comfort space, but let's kind of move and get some healing and help, you know, help others out. But it was really focusing was very difficult because of all the things coming at us. You know, those sessions that we were having, like Earl and I were going back and forth, and it's so gay, and we're like, yeah, we can say that. No, we can't say that. We can say this. No, we can't say that. Because we ultimate goal is we want people to learn and embrace what's going on and get involved. So.
Yeah. You know, one of the things, especially early on, that we struggled with was figuring out, you know, kind of what's the building block we need first? You know, because there were definitely people coming into the space and into the discussion who had been thinking about these topics and having this conversation for years and had presented on and been working in the DEI space. And then, you know, there were other people who were coming in and it was like, wow, I never really thought about it that way. And so trying to figure out how you pull together a conversation where some people are really starting it, you know, this is the first time I'm taking a serious look at this, along with people who have been like, you know, I've been eat, sleep, living and breathing this for 20, 40, 60 years. And then still have a conversation that is meaningful on both sides. And so, you know, figuring out how we made it accessible, but also rewarding, because, you know, we didn't want the entire onus of the conversation to fall on the shoulders of people who've been having this conversation for so long, but also wanted to make it a place where, you know, you could come in and be like, you know, I'll admit this is day one. I've never thought about it this way before, but I'm interested and I'm here and I want to learn. And, you know, so that was part of the reason we spent so much time on putting the presentations together and on making this, you know, not just a, okay, we're going to all show up for an hour and a half and turn on the mic and see what happens. You know, we wanted to make sure we had some content so that, you know, people who were there to learn had the opportunity to learn, but that we also had those opportunities for sharing, so that the people who, you know, were more there for the dialogue had that opportunity as well. So I think, you know, it really goes back to being really mindful of, you know, meeting people where they are and understanding that not everyone's in the same place.
It's okay. I think you were about to say something. I want to give you opportunity.
I was, but I think Gordell and Elizabeth have touched on that, okay. Meeting people where they were and allowing people to be in the chat if they wanted to, or being able to speak up when they wanted to off of mic, but just allowing people to be comfortable, but also trying to push their boundaries a little bit as well.
I'm glad the chat. It was very interesting as the session, over the course of the development of the series, started that it was almost all dialogue, but then people started becoming not quite ready to say anything out loud, but would chime in on the chat. And so you had to be very cognizant of paying attention to everything everyone was saying, but then also reading the chat, which got really robust. So it would be just back and forth and then people liking what other people were saying, and then so much outpouring of support. When people would open up and share things that are difficult to say or personal or emotional, and then there would just be a outpouring of love and support from other people in the firm about how much they appreciated people's willingness and openness. So that was really great to see too. I'm glad you mentioned the chat associates.
Okay, thank you so much for your answers. Let's go into a different perspective. So you've been able to give some insight to your internal workings around DEI, but let's look at the broader industry and other firms and even academic programs. What do you feel is missing, or what measures do you think should be implemented for the field in general?
That That is a really hard question. I can tell by everybody's face. They're like, man, that's a, I mean, oof, I'm going
to
take
my. I'm just trying not to make this nuclear. That's all.
Right, exactly. Like
I'm gonna go after Valerie because I know she got stuff to say.
I'm gonna go before Valerie, so that's gonna make hers that much more impactful, and then you can ease it on down.
This is like a sandwich. This is like a
right,
sandwich.
Exactly.
Go ahead.
You know, in my perspective, I'm a realist when it comes to what the reality of it is, and so, you know, when. And we see this across the board, not just in the design industry. You see this in education. You see this in higher ed. And, you know, we were just at a university the other day and they said, well, we want more Black administrators and teachers. And that's just one spectrum. And the thing we got to realize is, like, we are 13% of the whole pie. And so the idea that we are 13%, and that's across the board, it's not easy finding Black professors. It's not easy finding Black designers. It's not an easy thing. It's not like there's a room full of us and everybody's just picking. So, you know, the idea of saying, how do we get us in the profession more? It's really educating. It's really us being in avenues like this and showing youth of color or minority or whatever descent that this is a thing. Like being a designer, I mean, my daughter looks at it like this. She says, you're lucky. You got into a profession where all you got to do is draw and color every day and you get paid for it. And I was like, you're right. I did. I really did. And but it was because my parents made sure I had mentors that looked like me and ensured me that, hey, you can do this. It's not an impossible thing. And so it's not less, I guess what I'm saying is, it's not so much that I'm going to put that on the world to fix. I'm putting that more on my shoulders to fix, because if there's a youth or a child or a person of color that doesn't look at this as an avenue and they have a skill and they have a gift and they've been blessed with it, then it's up to me to make sure they know that, hey, guess what? You could live your whole life working a job. You love working, doing what you consider now as a hobby. We just got to move you in that direction. Now, that does not take care of the socioeconomic standard of what companies will hire. But from the aspect of getting people like myself and people of color in a position to understand that, hey, I can do this as a living and make money at it. That's where, from our standpoint, we have to kind of reach back and make sure that the education is out there for people to know that this is an option to get that more of that 13% even in the direction of these fields so they can actually get to the table to be in the position to kind of level the playing field a little bit. But like I said, it's never going to really be level because we're only 13% if we're just looking at the African-American community. And that's my quote. So I said, go ahead, Valerie, hit us with something harder.
All right. I'm going to take a different approach because Earl said what he said, and that's already on the table and we already know. Taking a different approach today and taking some of the burden off of our shoulders, you know, as Black people. We are out there. And when you get us, don't push us away. Keep us. Make an effort to keep us. We had the talk yesterday about Leslie Loco, about how she resigned and she was pretty much pushed out of, you know, the Pritzker School of Architecture, you know, being the dean there. We are there. Make an effort to keep us. We the burden is not always, you know, on us. We used to taking on that burden and say, okay, well, you know, because I'm a Black woman architect, I'm gonna go out there and cultivate all these other, you know, Black, you know, women architect. I have to be that example so that they can see it and aspire to it. But when we get in those positions, make an effort to keep us. Because when we are there, had Leslie Loco stayed and had she been treated well, that would have invited other people to enter that school, into that, to aspire to that same position. But when you see that there's so much adversity in that position, that's a deterrent. You know, it's like, I don't want to deal with that. You know, I can find something else to do, you know, outside of architecture. That would cause me less stress and I can make more money too. So I would say, you know, taking the stress off of us, make an effort to put in into your policies and your procedures to keep us there. You know, we don't have to be babied or anything like that, but just treat it like everybody else. And not expect it to overperform or anything like that. So that's what I have to say. It's a different take today, but Earl already said what he had to say. We know about the mentorship and everything, you know, getting to a point to where, you know, I'm kind of getting aggravated, you know, with, you know, that being the only thing and the responsibility being all on us. So that's my take for today.
Thank you, Valerie, because I'm gonna add to that. You sent me in the right direction.
Okay.
I will say this, you know, and hopefully this is a quote people remember. We've got to get past trying to check off a box to trying to change a life. And so I am in some great conversations with people, innocent enough starting out, that, you know, it's okay if that's where you start, but that should not be where you end. It takes a lot more effort to change a life than check off a box. Okay, I have two Hispanic registered architectural females. Okay, check. I have three Black, you know, female architects. Check. I have whatever you want to check off. And I meet the most well-intentioned people in the AEC industry that have such blinders on. And I'm okay with that if that's where you start. But you have to do things that are going to allow you to move forward. And maybe your voice should start being less so others that don't look like you or have different experiences can be more. And so that's the challenge I always put out there. Look, I'm gonna be right there with you. We're gonna navigate together, but it's probably not gonna look like the way you're used to it looking. And so I encourage people, be bold. Don't be in the same place next year that you are this year. And I guess the last thing I'll say is, do y'all still y'all realize that we're still in an era of firsts? When you look up, this is the first Black person to do this. This is the first Hispanic person to do this. This is the first woman to do that. That's the world we live in 2021. And so that should give you perspective about where we are. So you can see the passion coming out. So I'm going to be quiet and I'm going to let somebody else say so.
Jay, I thought I did real light. Like, usually I will go so militant, but today I was like pretty professional with my answer.
And I mean, we switched up
today. Man. Okay. Okay. I see what you're doing.
Good job, Earl.
I want to also jump in and say, you know, thinking about not just like bringing in people that are emerging professionals, or making sure that you have somebody at every level in your firm that you can, as Wardell was saying, that can challenge you and you not be, well, you're a, you know, a junior designer. Let me get rid of you because you challenged my thought. Making sure you have a senior level designer or a director or even middle career, you just making sure that you have that throughout your entire firm so that you can continue to grow in that effort.
And I think too, you know, and this is Valerie talking, kind of brought this to the top of my head. You know, if you're in an organization that is either struggling with recruitment or struggling with retention, not thinking we're not finding the right people, but thinking, what is it about our culture or about our organization or about our policies and procedures that is preventing success here? It's not the people you're bringing in that those individuals are not capable of success. It's that there's something about the organization or the culture that is not letting them thrive there. And I think it's very easy to be like, you know, well, I did the thing, I checked the box. And then, you know, 2 years later, everybody I hired is gone. And, you know, I did the thing, I checked the box. What can I do? But then, well, okay, but why? And it's that thing about like you ask why five times or something, like why? And it's like, oh, well, it's because of this. Well, why? Well, why? And, you know, not just accepting it as, well, that's what it is. And there's nothing that can be done. I mean, especially in an industry of people who are as creative as designers are, you can solve any problem. It's just about identifying the problem and then really committing to trying to figure out why and how do we fix it.
Thank you so much to all the panelists for your perspective. And now I'm going to open it up to our audience. I have two that have expressed questions. First, Tracy Ford, and then I have
questions in the chat, Ingrid. I think Tracy Ford asked, from EOA, asked about the series and if it was available for other firms. I'm going to defer to Earl.
I actually typed it in there.
Okay.
But I forgot to actually hit the enter button, so it's just been sitting up. We actually have had a lot of talks about that because we get that question a lot, which we want to. The one thing that we know we had to do is because we had a lot of our sessions, they started off with personal people's information and them telling a story about themselves. Elizabeth is not just our HR, she's our legal too. And so the question is really kind of like, okay, we just have to find the time to do it. And we just have to take out the pertinent information that's about individuals solely. I don't think there's anything holding us back from doing it. We keep a count of it. And right now they're all in PowerPoint, which they can be in anything. So it's just a matter of us saying, okay, what's the platform to do it with? But we've had a lot of requests for it. And it's something we're still discussing, but
I think that's definitely a not yet, but it's definitely before. I think the other thing, it's one of the things we talked about in the video, every firm is at a different place with this and has a different culture. Mm-hmm. And to take the Moody Nolan version of Walk the Talk off the shelf and just try to plug and play it at any firm across the country, it would definitely not work everywhere. It was specifically designed for our staff at that time in that moment. We're definitely talking about how we can make this so that it is plug and play and that it really could be broadly applicable. The other thing, there's the PowerPoint, but then there was the facilitation piece. Right now to just, kind of hand over what we've developed to someone else without having the facilitators who had like put all that together and so had all the information and all the context, it would be difficult for somebody else to just step in. So it's definitely something we want to do. And I think it would be really valuable industry-wide for us to be able to get it out there in a way that would be broadly applicable. There's just a little bit more groundwork we need to do to get it ready.
Thank you. And Tracy, did you have anything else you wanted to add to that?
I just want to say that the presentations just from seeing this presentation today, I bet they're just awesome. So I'm just super curious and would love to see the content. And I know, firms are willing to pay for that. We've invested in training and it's very important for us to put our money where our mouth is. So right. I think a lot of us out there are very willing to monetize that and for that to be a paid project as opposed to, in your spare time. So just know that we're super interested and we're all looking for really great content that's applicable.
Can I add to that? That kind of sparks something. I can't speak for everybody else, but knowing how much we've worked and how passionate we are about it. I mean, I am more than willing, as I'm sure some of the others, if they have the availability, is really to maybe even come and help and talk and help. Cause it really was a grassroots thing. Right. But we're all dealing with this in some form or fashion. And this is something that is worth putting your time to if we're going to impact and transform the industry we're in. Mm-hmm. Like, we need to be a leader in it. What we do affects so many things. The built environment affects so many things and can right so many wrongs. So, you can probably feel the passion coming out. But, hey, if wherever you are, I've got some good food and you fly me out, I'm there.
Yeah, I would also double down on what Elizabeth said too. It's like, we're Moody Nolan. We're, when you walk through the doors, everybody knows this is a Black owned, Afro American owned, founded firm. I'm going to be honest. I came from NBBJ, and I had been talking to people over here for a very long time before I actually came here, but I expected to come through the doors and see like. Where's
And so I'm going to do it. I got to.
Don't do it.
I know, because I saw it last night. I was thinking Black Panther. We about to, I'm going back to the motherland. And then I'm like, oh, wait a minute. Where are the Black people? And so, you know, but we're still 13%. Back to that. So the idea of what we needed is going to be totally different. Since we're the only one like this, it's going to be totally different from what we can walk into another firm with. If you were to take some of the presentations we have and walk into another firm, I don't even know what will happen. Like, I mean, I'm sure the minority is going to get inspired and try to take, I mean, it could be totally chaos, because some of these are hard conversations. And unless you're primed and already kind of in that space, for us, this works because we've been talking it, living it for so long being here. You go somewhere else and it's not going to be the same thing. And so, you know, back to, you know, Jay's, like, you could look at it and use it as a reference, but it really does need to be custom to your walk, to where your firm is at and to where the people are, so that you don't scare the heck out of everybody and it becomes something, you know, something that you didn't want. You don't want it to get sidetracked. So
the content is there. It's just about how you present it.
Exactly.
I did want to make sure I say this as well. Yes, you see this panel, and from Representative Moody Nolan, you know, it seems to be skewed African American. There's a lot more support with our firm. I just want you to know that. But we also have Asian Americans in our firm. We have, you know, when Asian Americans were being attacked, we had a session to talk about it.
Right.
We rally behind some of our other colleagues there. And so it's not, I don't want us to give off any representation that is just African American.
Right.
It's not. That's just kind of what you see here. So
thank you for everyone's answers. We have another question coming in from Jared. Jared, please come off mute and address the audience.
It was more I guess I was inspired to make a comment, and firstly saying that I appreciate the, you know, the commitment to this within the firm of Moody Nolan, and what I took from it was, like, this should be business as usual, right? And like what Wardell said, you know, like he said exactly what I wanted to say, is that because we impact the built environment, we have the responsibility and the privilege to know how we got here. And that's can't be a top down process, you know, because that we have to I guess we have to unlearn so much about and you mentioned that, you know, some topics like redlining and exclusion and covenants and zoning, but these things still persist in a lot of ways, and we're still kind of working against, you know, what the built environment is at the moment and what the built environment is has affected, you know, communities of color mainly, you know. And so it's not, you know, predisposition to these problems, but like we, you know, to me, you know, personally, I just feel like, you know, we have something to say about that. And so I just, you know, that was my comment. So thanks.
You know, and just try to piggyback on that, and then something that, you know, even Valerie and Ross said before, you know, especially with the question of, you know, what can you do? You know, we do truly believe, like, you know, the more diverse minds in a room, even if it's 2 to 3, the better the outcome. I remember being on a project, and we were doing a school and a daycare. And we're halfway through kind of figuring out the design. And then I'm looking around and I'm like, wait a minute, nobody on this team even has kids. Like, why would we be doing a daycare with no one on the team that even has a kid to tell us whether their kid would even like what we're doing? You know, and it's one of those things where that diversity isn't just about, you know, it's not just about this. It's about the different thought.
it's about saying, hey, we're doing an airport, or we're doing some part of a of something that has to do with this. Do we have a pilot, or do we have anybody that deals even in that range to give insight on things that we can't assume because we just don't know? You know, I can, you know, so it's when we talk about this diversity for us, and even with a lot of the sessions for Walking the Talk, it's not necessarily always saying about color. It's all, it's real mostly based around just different types of people, different trains of thought, because ultimately, yeah, we can design and hope we come up with the greatest idea all the time. But if we're really trying to actually change how people use experience and all those type of things, then we need to kind of get people that have to experience it already on the projects. Because like I said, or else you just got a whole bunch of, I mean, and what makes it worse is like the whole team was guys. So you got a whole bunch of guys deciding to take care and nobody has kids, which is the stupidest thing on the planet when you really think about it. So that's where we're trying to get to, is that understanding and that empathy and understanding of like, this is why I need somebody different than myself to even primer what I think is a great idea, you know? So I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. I want to see, I want to gauge if there's any more questions for the audience. We're getting close to time, but we have time for one more question. So if you have a question, you can either raise your hand depending on the system that you're using, or you can come off mute and address the group.
So I'm going to add here, because this seem, as the panel knows, this is the rhythm that when we do Walk the Talk, it's like, and it, you know, as people get warmed up and they, you know, ask whatever question you want, you know, we can say this is a safe space, because it really is. I think that the key is this is the space where courage is needed for us to move this forward. And not that you have to come up with some question, but if there's something you want to ask it. This is what this is for. So I just want to make that point of kind of what this space is, what the purpose of this is.
Yeah, and I'll go ahead and start to kind of wrap up. And if there are any, oh, Teresa, you have your hand up. All right, Teresa Cole.
All right. I'm going to bungle this, I'm sure. But the question that I have is, how do we change the way that we approach architecture and the projects so that the project delivery system, so that we can create more equitable spaces? You know, we as architects, we're kind of, you know, stuck with the zoning and the socioeconomic realities, and we are doing jobs, so we need to get paid, and all of these different things kind of temper what we want to do to address inequality and to be able to do a project that is great, that brings beautiful things to a neighborhood, but not be told that it's gentrification. Like, how do we address how architecture is actually delivered and make it more equitable for everyone? It's a big question.
It's a hard question, and it's a hard question, and because we've been put in that position a lot. We get put in that position a lot. You know, we, oh my God, I remember, quick story. There was a development in part of downtown that went up, and as one of the designers, they wanted me to present to the city, since I do a lot of presenting to city municipalities and community work. And the developer was like, all right, now I got to primer this. There's a lot of talk about how this is a gentrificated project. And so you may get some questions about that. But what you need to do is, you know, we didn't even know what you're going to say. I'm like, well, it is gentrification. And they're like, yeah, but we can't say that. I was like, well, I'm not going to lie. It is. It's like, what do you want me to do? Oh, obviously, they didn't have me speak to the city. So I didn't go to that meeting, because I'm not going to lie about it and say what it is. But, you know, we're also doing
something in Cincinnati right now. And if anybody knows the Rhine area of Cincinnati, it's a big controversy over gentrification. But what we've done is, since we were doing the analysis and the visioning session with the community, with the city, and with Parks and Rec on what we're going to put there, we embraced the fact that it is gentrification. So how do you counter gentrification? Is not by saying, well, we're not going to build something nice. No, what it is like, okay, how we approached it was saying, now this is, yes, we want this building and this building needs to have all this stuff in it, but this is the infrastructure you got to put in place for the people that live here to be able to use that building, or else you're going to gentrify them because they're going to have to leave, and you're going to buy the property, you're going to sell it for three times as much, and the whole community is going to go from something that was 96% Black to pretty much, you know, 96% white. And so the city was actually really interested in hearing it, because now the whole conversation is about infrastructure. It's like, yeah, okay, forget the building for a minute. What are you talking about we need to put in place? The financial aspect. You know, there's so many different aspects to that community that need to be there before this building even comes online, so that the people that live there can actually, for one, grow, get better, and actually utilize what you're talking about putting there 10 years. It's about getting that conversation started beforehand and not waiting till after the building goes up and after the whole community changes, then everybody's like, oh crap, it got gentrified. What did you think was going to happen? You took a building that someone had lived in for 30, 40 years and generational, moved them out, renovated. Now you're selling it for three times as much, and they couldn't move back into it even if they wanted to. And so really just taking a stance and understanding that, again, a hard conversation, because the people that were paying our bills did not want us to have this conversation with the city and Parks and Rec until it got to the point where we said, hey, if we're not going to have the conversation, we don't need to be in the room, because you're going to sell them on a bill of goods that we can't back up. And at the end of the day, they said, okay, well, no, you know what? If that's the right thing to do, come tell the story. And the city loved it. The city embraced it. Parks and Rec embraced it. They're looking at a whole new plan of saying, okay, now what can we do in this area so we don't keep doing what's been happening over the last 10 years to this area? So it's really kind of just taking a stand and stepping out on faith and knowing you're talking about something that's the best for it. It's really hard to punish someone when you know what they're telling you is for the betterment of all of us. They may not listen to you, but it's really hard for them to really punish you by it, because, you know, most people have consciences, they have families, and they got to look them in the eyes, but you know what's right. And to just, you know, obviously we're architects, we got to build buildings. We're going to do the project because we want the money, but how we package it and how we talk about it and how we sell it is all up to us. And so we can really do it in a way that kind of counters the socioeconomic standings of what it would be any other place, and take a stand and say something. But I'll leave that. I know Jake is probably itching to say something. So,
yeah. So the thing I like about the group that we have is that we dialogue. We don't always have the exact same perspective, and that's okay. But we navigate that. I would say this. There's a couple things that I think have to be anchors for us if we truly want to impact and transform the AEC industry. We have to have a fundamental thought as to what is the purpose of architecture. If your statement is to create great buildings, you are wrong. The purpose of architecture should be to serve people. And I know everybody's not going to like that, but if that is not your motivation holistically, I really believe like we're missing the point. And so I think we as architects are savvy. So I know we don't do it just to do it. Obviously we're in it because we like it, and we have to make some, you know, and it's to make money. I understand that. So that's always present. But I think, to Earl's point, I think there are places or moments within what we do where we can help steer how we navigate things. The type of clients you have, you know, the type of even people you might be working with, they're about the bottom line. They're about this or that. Is there a way you can influence them in a positive direction to start being more mindful and considerate of the people that architecture affects? And how do we do that? I think it's little by little. It's like eating an elephant, you know, bite by bite, but you're making some progress. But it, you always have to be making some progress and pushing it forward. So you tagged in, Valerie.
Yeah. It was interesting that my, before you even started talking, Errol, my story was going to be a developer story. All right. So we really have to get into the minds and hearts of these developers. And I'm going to tell a quick story, just how savage it is out here with these developers. Working on a city led proposal with a developer, and there's a community engagement piece to this project. So we as architects, we said, we're gonna do this, the community's gonna love this and blah, blah, blah. You know, we tell everything that we're gonna do for the community, you know, what the community needs. Well, developer, their answer to us was, who's scoring this, the city or the community? So that is how real, you know, it is out here with these developers. If it doesn't pencil in, you know, a lot of times they don't even want to hear about it. So we need to continue to come to the table to them as trusted advisors and kind of, and I'm still steering. I'm steering this developer client, you know, it's just like, you have to keep, you know, let's get back in the rails, you know, on this, you know, but, you know, you have to keep. And even if you have to tell some personal stories, I've gotten to the point to where, you know, I have had to tell some personal stories so that they would understand that what they're doing, how they are really impacting people. And so a lot of times they don't really understand, you know, they feel like they're you know, doing this great development. We build it, they're gonna like it. They're gonna come, they're gonna spend money. You know, they're gonna have this. But, you know, there's a reality of what they are doing that they may not understand. And those are the things that we have to speak to them on.
And just to real quick on what Valerie said, and it's not, and we're not saying like all developers are the devil or something like that. No, the idea is that people don't know what they don't know. You know, there's experiences that all of you have had on the or have on this call that, you know, I don't know. Just like when you brought your friend over for the first time to come to your house. And, you know, if you came over to my house, you say hi to everybody before you just go walking through the house thinking you're going to have a game. Well, that's how my mama and my family did it in our house. It might be different in your house. And so the idea is just like Valerie said, it's like, you know, sometimes they just don't know. And I think either Valerie or Jay said something to me that's always stuck with me. No offense to anybody on the call, a white person go their whole life without dealing with, needing, or having to rely on a Black person, just like that. And their life might even be better, who knows? We can't do that. Minorities can't do that. We don't have that choice. We don't have that luxury, if that's what you want to look at it. So there's things that I know that they don't know. And so sometimes you just got to tell them. And just like she said, sometimes you got to tell them a story. You got to get them to understand that, guess what? You're not the only one in this world. You're definitely not going to be the only one that's going to use this building. And you're not going to be the only one that's going to benefit from it. So let's look at some other sides that they may not know. And you'd be surprised if the argument is good enough and it makes sense. A lot of people will say, okay, let's think about that. Let's look at it. But you can't crucify them for not knowing, because they don't have to. If you're telling me you could go your whole life without ever seeing, dealing with, or talking to a Black person, then guess what? They have the luxury of not knowing. We don't, because that's not the world we live in.
Yep. Team, I'm being directed to wrap it up. I'm going to throw Ingrid under the bus. So this has been a really great session. I don't know, Elizabeth, if you could kind of maybe type what it is that you want to say in the chat.
I was just going to say, I think that it'll take me 2 seconds. I think there's a lot of overlap between trying to get clients who don't want to design sustainably. They don't know that that's what they want to do. They're just looking at the dollars. We can make an argument about why that makes sense. I think equitable design is the same way. So it's the role of the designer to, you know, convince the client, like, you don't know you want this, but let me tell you that you actually do want this.
Absolutely. So overlap there. Yeah, absolutely. Well, I wanted to thank everybody for coming today. We're going to start to close out here. I'm so excited and so happy. I'm like a kid in the candy store, because when we as Moody Nolan started having these talks, I was like, have you ever like been watching a movie by yourself and like something really interesting happened? You just start looking around the room and it's like nobody did. That's how I felt. I was like, everybody needs to know about this. And, you know, so I was like, when we started planning, you know, being on the JE+DI committee, we started planning these talks. I was like, I definitely want to get Moody Nolan here to talk about our Walk the Talk series, because it's been so helpful. It has been a healing source of healing. I equate it to therapy when, you know, especially when it first started, it was therapy. So the editing that they have to do is all my snot nose crying out of the video. And it wasn't just me, you know, people were really, you know, it was some healing happening there, you know. So I really thank everyone for coming. We are so, so happy to share. And thanks, you know, does anybody from AIA want to do closing marks for the whole series? But if not, I will. Thank you all for just joining in this whole series. And I'll throw it to Ingrid, just really quickly, Ingrid, if you want to say anything else.
No, I just wanted to say, you know, thank you for participating. Make sure that you include your name and your AIA number in the chat, especially those of you who have been here all three times. Thank you so much. And then, of course, thank you for being engaged and making this session interactive and engaging. And I hope you have a good rest of the day. And thank you so much for your participation, especially our panelists.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.